to my channel. I'm Farah, and in today's video, we're going to talk about OAuth 2.0. But before we get into this video, I want to tell you that this video is sponsored by Integrity. Integrity is a bug bounty platform, and it has a lot of programs from companies that are mostly based in Europe. But don't worry, even if you're not in Europe, you can still hunt on it. So thank you, Integrity, for sponsoring this video and helping me grow. And you should definitely check out their website and sign up as a bug bounty hunter using my link below. And if you're interested, then please continue watching. So I used a lab from GitHub in this video, and I have linked it down below along with any other resource that helped me to make this video, so you can check it out. So what is OAuth 2.0? OAuth stands for Open Authorization, and it's a framework that you might have seen being utilized by applications to allow their users to log in through Facebook, Google, etc., so that their users don't need any specific username or password to log into that app. So where is OAuth used? Like I said before, OAuth is used by applications to allow users to seamlessly log in without creating a separate username or password for that application. It's also used by enterprises for SSOs, and it's also used for resource sharing, for example, importing contacts and importing pictures from one application to another. There are four main entities in OAuth. First is the user, who's also the resource owner. Then we have the application or the client, which requires the user to log in. For example, here we have Codecademy and Codecademy's login page, and we can see that we have options to log in with Facebook, Google, LinkedIn. And if we use Facebook to log in, then the third entity is the authorization server of Facebook, which verifies the identity of the user. And then we have the resource server, which is also by Facebook, which hosts and protects the user's account details. There are four types of OAuth flows. First is authorization code grant, then we have implicit grant, then we have resource owner credentials grant, and finally client credentials grant. But the most common ones are authorization code grant and implicit grant, so that's what we're going to focus on in this video. The authorization code grant is used when an application requests for an authorization code and then exchanges it for an access token, which gives him access to the user's account details. So let's look at the flow of this to understand what exactly happens. And for better understanding, we'll use Codecademy as the application or the client and assume that the user logs in through Facebook. First, when the user clicks on the login with Facebook button, he is redirected to Facebook's authorization server with the following link. And this link contains all the parameters that will be verified by Facebook. First, we have the client ID, which is a public identifier for Codecademy. Then we have the redirect URI with Codecademy's URL, where the user will be taken after he logs in. Then we have the response type, which is code, which means that Codecademy needs an authorization code from Facebook. Then we have the scope, which defines the resources that Codecademy needs permission for. And here Codecademy needs the name, profile picture, and email address of the user from his Facebook account. And then we have state. State parameter is optional, but it contains a CSRF token. The user then logs into his Facebook account and approves Codecademy to access his information. Once Facebook receives the user's approval, it will send an authorization code to Codecademy. Codecademy uses that code and requests an access token from Facebook's authorization server. Facebook verifies the received code and sends an access token to Codecademy. Codecademy uses that access token, sends it to Facebook's resource server in exchange for the user's details. So let's look at the implicit grant flow now. In this case, instead of receiving an authorization code and then exchanging it for an access token, the application directly receives an access token. And for better understanding, in this flow, we'll be using Cora as the client or the application, and we'll assume that the user logs in through Facebook. So first, when the user clicks on the login with Facebook button, he's redirected to Facebook's authorization server with the following link. Now this link has a lot more parameters because Cora uses Facebook's SDK, but we don't need to look at that right now. The rest of the parameters are pretty much the same. The only difference is that the response type is token instead of code. The user then logs into Facebook and approves Cora to access his details. Once Facebook receives the user's approval, it will send an access token to Cora. Quora uses that access token to retrieve the user's account details from Facebook's resource server. So now that we're done with how OAuth 2.0 works, let's look at some bugs now. The first one is reusing authorization tokens. Sometimes the client doesn't expire used tokens, and if the URL with the token is leaked anywhere, then an attacker can get a full account takeover by using that token. So let's look at our lab now. Okay, so I have my lab right here, and as you can see, this application is called PhotoPrint. This is my client, and it allows importing photos from a gallery photo sharing website. So I'm going to print pictures from gallery, forward it, and you can see that I have my OAuth request with all the parameters here. So let's forward this, and I have the login page of the gallery application over here. So I'm going to log in, and I have my OAuth request again with all the parameters that we talked about earlier. I'm going to allow, and you can see once I allow it, I receive a code. So I'm going to send this request to repeater, and after I send this, I can see that I'm redirected back to the PhotoPrint application. And I have all the photos that are hosted on the gallery. And I'm going to go back to repeater now and see the request that I have over there. So I'm going to try and send it to see if it works. I am being redirected, so let's follow redirection and let's scroll down. And as you can see, I have found, photos are found, so which means that the request has worked and the code hasn't expired. So the next bug is the redirect URI not being validated. So if the redirect URI is not being validated properly, then it's possible for an attacker to get a full account takeover by tricking a victim to click on an OAuth login link where the redirect URI is an attacker controlled domain. And once the user clicks on that link and logs in, the attacker can capture the token received by him. So let's go to our lab now. Okay, so as you can see, I have my lab right here. I'm going to print pictures from gallery and forward it, and in this request I'm going to change the redirect URI from PhotoPrint to a domain that I control. So once I do that, I'm going to forward the request, I'm going to log in, and allow. And as you can see that I have been redirected to the attacker's website, and the code is also available in the URL. So now I'm going to use that code to log in. So if an attacker had this code, he would go to the PhotoPrint application and he would go to the URL where he can input the code, and he would enter the code capture, and then he would be logged into the victim's account and he can see the victim's photos over here. So when testing for this bug in real life applications, if an external domain is not allowed, then you can always try to change the redirect URI to a subdomain of the application, or you can change it to a page where you have found an XSS vulnerability or even an open redirect. The next bug that we're going to talk about is CSRF. So like I said earlier, the state parameter is optional. So if it's not present, then the entire flow is open to CSRF attacks. Sometimes I've also seen the state parameter having a static value, which means that it's not checked by the client at all. And you can also try some normal CSRF bypasses like removing the state parameter completely. So let's go to our lab now. Okay, so I have my lab here and I'm going to print pictures from gallery. I'm going to allow. And after I allow, you can see that I'm getting my code along with the state parameter here. So let's try to change the state parameter and see what happens. So when I forward it, you can see that I'm being blocked and it's detecting the CSRF attempt. So let's go back and try again. And this time we'll use a bypass. So I'm going to the PhotoPrint application, printing pictures, and I'm going to click on allow. And Now what I'm going to do is remove the state parameter completely and then forward it. And you can see that this time it's worked and I have access to the photos from gallery now. So that's it for this video. I hope you found this helpful. If you did, then like this video and subscribe to my channel because I'm going to be posting videos like this a lot more often. And thank you for watching. Bye.